In this very exciting video lecture, I want to introduce you to the Feynman technique of integration. We're going to differentiate under the integral sign. Now we're going to go through this step by step, but instead of me writing on the whiteboard or writing it out by hand on paper, I'm just going to show you the equations on the screen here, but we're going to go through them step by step. I am in the Mathematica programming environment here using the Wolfram language, which is a fantastic language if you're interested in doing your mathematics. Plus it can do so much more. And I'm just going to use one or two lines of code just as an illustration. But all the equations are here on the screen and we're going to go through them step by step. So we have here a problem set up for us. It's the definite integral in going from 0 to infinity of the sine of x over x with respect to x. Now you can try any of the common techniques that you might have learned about. You are going to have problems trying to solve this. This little x here in the denominator is just going to make life very difficult for you. There is a solution to this though, and I've used the Wolfram language. I'm just going to use the integrate function, the sine of x over x, and it's a definite integral with respect to x going from 0 to infinity. And lo and behold, I see that the answer is pi over 2. Now, how to get to the pi over 2? Just as motivation for why there should be a solution, let's just plot this function. We create a graph of this function on this domain from 0 to 12 pi. And you can see that it oscillates, but it gets smaller and smaller, so we are converging. So there should be a solution to this area under the curve. And indeed, we see it is pi over 2. But how to do it? Feynman's technique of differentiating under the integral sign to the rescue. And we're going to set that up in a beautiful way, as you can see here. We're going to introduce a new expression here inside of our integral, in as part of the integrand. And yes, of course, it totally changes the integrand, but let me show you something very beautiful. Let's, by introducing this new expression, set this equal to something new, a function that I'm going to call I of a variable b to denote this new variable that I'm introducing there, b. Because, look at this, if we set b equal to 0, this equation here, this section here, becomes 1. E to the power negative 0 times x is e to the power 0, that's just 1. And we do indeed just have what we want. So imagine we could solve this little problem here instead of the original, and eventually just put b equal to 0. So we're going to solve this, and eventually just put b equal to 0. We are going to have a solution to our original problem. One thing though, and it's going to come up later, I put a negative bx there. And I'm putting the negative bx there because that means it goes into the denominator, and the term actually disappears from here as b becomes very large, because it's going to tend to 0, so as not to influence what we have up here. And why the e to the power negative bx? Well, you can try lots of other expressions to put in there, and indeed, if someone shows you how to do this, they might go through a couple, and none of them work. The e to the power negative bx, that really works. Let's carry on with that. Now, how to solve for this? The next little trick up our sleeve is just to integrate both sides with respect to b. So I have my equation here. I'm going to integrate both sides with respect to b, and that's what we have down here. I have di db, and because this is an integration with respect to b and not to x, I'm just using partial derivative notation here. You needn't do that, but just to show that I'm taking the partial derivative of b. So I'm taking the derivative of b with respect to b on both sides. Now, without motivation or proof, I'm just going to use Leibniz's rule, and I'm going to move my differentiation here inside of the integral, which is what we have down here. And that is where the Feynman technique comes in, this differentiating under the integral sign, because I'm now doing a differentiation inside of the integration. So let's just look at this little bit here, which is what we have down here. The partial derivative with respect to b of this expression. Now, because x is a constant, this is a very easy integral to do, because the sine of x just stays. There's a sine of x over x. So I'm just left with doing this integration here, reminding myself that x is a constant. So I'm going to be left with e to the power negative bx. And by the chain rule, I still have to integrate my power here. And that just leaves me with a negative x there. And lo and behold, my x will now cancel because I've got an x in the numerator and the x in the denominator, and I'm left with this. Very beautiful. So let's plug this back into this section here, which is what we've done here, except that I've put the negative that I have there outside of my integral. So that I have the derivative of y with respect to b equals negative this definite integral going from 0 to infinity with respect to x of this new integrand. And if you look at this new integrand, it's just very simply the product of two functions. So I can use integration by parts, no problem. And what I've done for you here is just color code things. Remember, this is how we do integration by parts. It's just a matter of, you might be more familiar with having this as the f of x g prime of x equals the f of x times the g of x minus the integral then of the f prime of x times the g of x. I'm using u and v. They are functions of x. The only choice now is which part is going to be u or f and which part is going to be v prime or g prime. And this is the way around I've done it. And if that is u and that's v prime, I show you what u prime and v is, or f prime and g. And we plug that back into our little formula that we have up there. So there's my u, there's my v, and there I have u prime and v. All I want to do is just very quickly simplify things a little bit. So the negative cosine x there I bring to the front here. And I'm going to bring out this b here to the front there. And I note that in the negative times the negative is a positive. So I'm left with this. Now you might suggest that I haven't really done anything because it's not easier, but you've done integration by parts before. And you know that we're just going to do integration by parts of this part once again. And again, this is going to be my, this first part is going to be my u, and this is going to be my v prime. And we have set it, I've set it up here so that you can see, and we're just going to put that all the way back. So there's my negative b. My negative b is my negative b there. So I'm just doing inside of the square brackets, I'm doing this integral here. So again, I have u and v, and I have u prime and v there. All I've done this time, I've just brought the b out again so that it is there. Check by hand, you'll see this is just integration by parts of this section here. What I want to do is just multiply this b out, the b that I had brought out in front there, through this square bracket expression here so that I get a negative b there and a negative b squared there. So I get the negative b squared over on that side. So what happens from here on? Well, if you notice very carefully, just mind that I've brought that negative out as well, and that's why that's a negative, is that on the right-hand side, I have exactly what I have on the left-hand side. So I can bring this negative b squared with its integral over to the left-hand side, which means I've got my integral plus b squared times my same integral equals then the right-hand side. I can take my integral out here as a common factor, which means I'm left with 1 minus b squared on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, I can simplify by taking negative e to the power e minus bx out as a common factor, and I'm left with cosine of x plus the b times the sine of x on the right-hand side. I can divide both sides by 1 over b squared, 1 over b squared we have there. So I'm left with my original problem, and I now have a solution to that problem. Just to show you with a line of code again, just to make sure that we are doing the right thing, I'm using integrate there, negative e to the power bx times the sine of x with respect to x, and I get exactly the same solution as we have up there using the Wolfram language. No problem. Now, we have to find a solution of our first derivative of, we have it at least with respect to b. And let's plug that in, and don't forget the negative sign that we originally had. So it's there, and I must just remember, there it is, that this is x going from 0 to x going to infinity. Now let's plug in x to infinity and then x equals 0 to get this derivative of I with respect to b. So I've plugged in infinity all over where we had b, and here I've plugged in 0. Now this term here, cosine and b times the sine, remember that depending on what b is, this is not the term that is going to drive this process. Remember, b was a positive value, so this actually goes inside of the denominator, and I already have this infinity term there, so the denominator far outpaces the numerator here, so this whole term goes to zero, and I'm left with on this side the negative, which is the negative there, and the cosine of zero is 1, sine of zero is 0, 1 plus 0 squared is 1, so I'm left with this very simple equation, that the derivative of I with respect to b is negative 1 over b squared plus 1. Brilliant, brilliant. But remember, we're still interested really in the I of 0, not in the derivative of I with respect to b, and that b being 0. No, we need I, so how do I get I back from this? Well, very easy, I integrate both sides with respect to b. So there we have the indefinite integral with respect to b and the indefinite integral with respect to b. And if I use the Wolfram language, it's just negative the arctangent of b. Just a reminder that the Wolfram language assumes that you know that this was an indefinite integral and that you should put the constant of integration there yourself. Now, let's just do this by hand. We did integration by hand up there. So let's just use trigonometric substitution to do this little integral here on the right-hand side. Very easy to do. We're going to let b equals the tangent of a new variable theta. That means the theta is the arctangent of b. And b squared plus 1 would be the tangent squared of theta plus 1. And I use a trig identity to show that that's just equal to the secant square. And if I take dB d theta, the first derivative of the tangent of theta with respect to theta is just the secant square of theta. I'm just bringing this d theta over to the right-hand side, so I have dB equals secant squared of theta d theta. So I have everything here to do my trig substitution. Let's do that. So that was my original problem. I plug in everything for dB. I'm plugging in secant squared theta d theta. And for my b squared plus 1, I have the tangent squared plus 1. I should put that theta over there, not over there. Let's just delete that. Remember that the theta should be on this side. Let's just put it in. I can't just leave that as such. There we go, tangent of theta. Remember that the tangent squared of theta plus 1, that's just the secant squared. Those two cancel out, so I'm looking at the negative indefinite integral of 1 d theta. That is negative theta plus c. But remember theta up there, that's the arctangent of b, so it's negative the arctangent of b plus some constant c. So I have this back. The I of b, which is what I originally wanted, negative the arctangent of b plus c, and that equals this original problem that I had. I just have to plug in b equals 0. My problem is I have a new constant there, c, and I have to get the solution to that constant. Now that's actually quite easy to do if you think about it. Remember, right, initially I said if we let b go to infinity, we are actually going to make that term smaller and smaller and smaller. So let's do that. Let's take I with b equals infinity. That leaves me with negative the arctan of infinity plus c. And I just plug in infinity with b everywhere, there. And if I think about this e to the power negative infinity x times x, that goes into the denominator. This term blows up. And the sine of x just oscillates between 1 and negative 1. So this part here actually goes to, this is actually just 0. E to the power negative infinity, and e to the power infinity in the denominator means this term is just 0. So I'm left with the fact that on the right-hand side I have this definite integral in going of 0 dx. And remember, that's just equal to 0. Just remember that negative the arctan of infinity, that's actually negative pi over 2, plus c equals 0. So lo and behold, I have a solution for c. Just to show you that the arctan of infinity is actually pi over 2. So we have the negative pi over 2 there. And we have a solution for c. So there we have it. I have, after all of that work, I of b equals negative the arctan of b plus pi over 2. C is pi over 2. And what did I want to do? I wanted to set b equal to 0 because that was going to be a solution to my problem. So we have a negative there, negative the arctan of 0 plus pi over 2, the arctan of 0 is just 0, and I'm left with the pi over 2. I of 0 is the pi over 2. Just before I let you go, just remember what this looks like, the arctangent function. We can see if this goes out to infinity, we're going to get to pi over 2, but the arctangent of 0 is 0, just to show you there. And there we have our solution, that the definite integral of going from 0 to infinity of the sine of x of x with respect to x is just pi over 2, Feynman's technique of differentiating under the integral sign. It is beautiful indeed.